Check 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is a... Okay. Testing. I'll go ahead and start so that we can get going. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Jim Coleman. I'm the Chief of Staff to Senator Greg Baldwin, and it's a pleasure to have you here today for our first of many roundtable discussions on a very important topic to Senator Ball, public-private partnerships. We're going to, if you open up your booklets that we gave you or that we're writing from the new, you'll find your agenda for our meeting that we have today. And as you can see, the first thing that we're going to do is to introduce Senator Ball. He will then go into opening remarks. I will then cover the legislative process, and the most important reason of why you're here is that you are now officially a part of Senator Greg Ball's Public Private Partnership Advisory Council. And all legislation starts with our constituents. So we want you on board with us to help us in creating the bill, helping Senator Ball to introduce it in the New York State Senate, as well as having our partner over in the Assembly, Assemblyman Castilli, as well as all of their colleagues, and then to get that to the governor. So I'll go through that process, and then we'll introduce our five panelists that we have here today. I'm excited that they have joined us. I'll introduce them, and then we'll have open discussion and roundtable feedback about the legislation that we're looking to have in the Senate and the Assembly, as well as any open communication about public-private partnership. John Raddatz is our co-sponsor today. He is the Executive Vice President and Chief Operating Officer for the Business Council of Westchester. It is a pleasure to have him as a partner, and we couldn't do it without him. So, John, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, and I want to thank Senator Ball. I mean, you can see turnout like this in the dog days of August shows that this is an issue that the senator has recognized really needs to be addressed, and more importantly, there are stakeholders from throughout Westchester County and other counties who really want to learn more about this legislation. I just wanted to thank the senator for reaching out to us. We at the Business Council of Westchester obviously are always wanting to work with legislators who really want to work with us in helping to be a voice for businesses. At the Business Council of Westchester, we have over 1,000 members, ranging from sole entrepreneurs to small businesses to mid-sized companies to the multi-international companies that call Westchester home. And they all need a voice. They need to have advocates who are going to work for them on the state and federal and local levels. And Senator Ball has shown from the moment he stepped foot into Albany that he really does understand what it means to open a business, to run a business, and what it means to sometimes have government help, and in other cases, get out of the way so businesses can grow. So I want to congratulate Senator Ball for this piece of legislation. I also should know that, you know, one of the things that we pride ourselves on is a legislative agenda that we do each year. And this was my first year at the Business Council of Westchester, and the first legislator that I had the opportunity to sit down with and review this with was Senator Ball. We went through it page by page. He gave me some good feedback, and we actually went back and retooled some of it from the feedback that we got. So we want to thank him for that. I also want to say something else as a former state assemblyman. Gives me the luxury to maybe say some things that others might not be able to say. When a legislator writes a piece of legislation, it can be 6 pages long, it can be a paragraph long, but the ramifications of that legislation can have huge, huge impacts in different industries. Some of it positive, sometimes negative. This piece of legislation that you're going to hear about today is for the future of New York and for projects that can help create economic growth and jobs. So, Senator, thank you for hosting this tonight. Thank you for working with not only the Business Council of Westchester, but businesses throughout the county and throughout the state.
Thank you. Thanks so much, Sean. Bob, do you want to say a few words?
Other than the fact that
as you probably all know, many of you know me, the fact that public-private partnerships is the way of the future. The reality is government doesn't always work efficiently. By public-private partnerships, we can achieve economies of scale and scope, and we can create the necessary savings that we need to do to save this state. As our governor has said, New York is open for business again, but we can't keep it open for business again unless we have a partnership with those businesses that we want to retain and we want to grow in New York State. So I thank the senator for hosting this. He and I have been partners on this from the beginning, and it's my pleasure to continue to part with him in the future.
And I learned at the Air Force Academy to be brief and be seated. So, Mayor, I'm already seated, but I'll make sure that I'm brief. But I'll just say with this governor, we've got to make sure that he has the tools that he needs, whether it be the Tappan Zee Bridge project, which is a huge project, literally leading to the employment of tens of thousands of people. When we talk about construction, putting blue-collar people to work, allowing people to pay their mortgage payment, pay their taxes, send their kids to college, these are the type of jobs that we need to be generating. And there are, in the state of New York, there are hurdles after hurdle after hurdle. We live in the capital of capital, and if we can engage the private sector in these infrastructure improvements that have been done in other states and certainly in other countries, I believe over 30 states allow this type of framework. If you take the Tappan Zee Bridge, where we're looking at calling it transit ready, it's my understanding that the George Washington Bridge was transit ready, and that never happened. And we certainly don't want that to happen with the Tappan Zee Bridge. But the reality is that we live in a world of finite resources at this point, and maybe for some time. And being able to give this governor the tools that he needs to leverage the private sector will allow us to create the jobs and get the job done the way it needs to be done. So I can't wait to hear from the experts and each and every one of you. I know, at least in the previous legislation, I believe the governor is totally on board with this. The Senate, we can get this done. I believe we're going to have to develop a real framework to get this passed through both houses to place it on the governor's desk. So.
Thank you very much, Senator. Now go through the legislative process. And as you're looking at this legislative process, again, you are officially today a part of Senator Greg Ball's Public-Private Partnership Task Force and Advisory Council. As I was saying a little bit earlier, all legislation starts with ideas from our constituents. You are our constituents. And we are looking to you for feedback, ideas on how we can make public-private partnerships come alive in New York. Over 30 other states throughout the union are using this concept to help them to accelerate job creation and to build their states and cities. We want to do the same thing here in New York. Ideas are started by you today, hearing your feedback about what we need to do going forward. From there, we would then go into the bill drafting stage of taking your ideas and feedback and putting it in a format that could then be presented in the legislature. Then it would be introduced after we have an actual bill drafted up. It would go into a committee up in Albany. We haven't chosen yet which committee, but there could be a host of different committees of where this type of bill would go, with Senator Ball being the prime sponsor. Then we would have it on the calendar with the majority leader in the Senate to where it would then be debated within the Senate. At that point, you would have amendments. Various senators would want to have feedback and share their ideas and amendments. Then we would pass a bill in the Senate. That same process would take place then over in the Assembly where Assemblyman Castilli is, as well as where John Ravitz was. That same process from the idea stage, the bill drafting, and we would work with them over in the Assembly, but they would take it through the same process. At that point, there may be some differences between the two bills that are passed in those two houses of the legislature. That's where the conference committee step would come in, where there would be some negotiations back and forth on being able to come up with a final bill that would then be presented to the governor for signing. Senator Ball would like to have a bill presented on the floor of the Senate, passed in the Senate, and passed in the Assembly, on the governor's desk by the end of the next session next year. We need this in New York, and we need your help. And that's why we're here today. I'd like to now start with our panelists. The first panelist that we're going to have to come up is Jamie Rawl. And Jamie Rawl, in addition to being a public-private partnership expert, she is also a major expert in the area of research and publications that have addressed transportation governance throughout the country. She's got a major focus in helping various states and organizations to be able to find ways to finance transit and rail, aviation support, technologies, and other issues. She also co-staffs the National Conference of State Legislatures Standing Committee on Transportation, made up of state legislators and legislative staff across the country. Jamie, why don't you come on up, and I'll put your PowerPoint up. You all can give her a round of applause while I'm doing this. There you go. Sorry about that. Here we go. Sorry about that. You got it. Up and down. You got it.
For some reason, my title has disappeared on the slide, so hopefully everything will be up here, but if it isn't, I'll just say it aloud. Well, I'm Jamie Rall from NCSL, and thank you very much for including me in the panel today. I'm very pleased to be here, especially as this event can be by our constituents, state legislatures, and legislative staff as well. Oh, that's what's happening. NCSL is a bipartisan organization. For those of you who don't know, it's nationwide. We represent and serve the more than 7,000 legislators and more than 30,000 legislative staff of all of the legislatures in all the states, commonwealths, and territories, and we cover everything that a state might ever have to address, not just transportation, but everything from same-sex marriage to education to pension reform and many other things that are in the news every day across the states. We do this through research and information, technical assistance, meetings, and lobbying at the federal level for states' interests. And I will say that because we represent and serve the states, we are not in a position to advocate for particular state approaches. So my role here today is to talk more about what's happening broadly across all the states in regards to PPP legislation that's been introduced and enacted, and some of the benefits and challenges that have been identified by our constituents in working with this issue in state houses across the country. I'm also going to provide a little bit of context about why there's so much intense interest around public-private partnerships. This is really because nationwide, states are facing a chronic, well-documented, and worsening transportation funding crisis that's characterized by gaps between revenues at all levels of government and the needs for investment. The estimated gap right now just to maintain surface transportation systems nationwide is anywhere between $58 and $113 billion each year. To maintain and improve it, up to $185 billion, and $8.5 billion of that each year is just to maintain transit and accommodate increased ridership projections. The reasons for the gaps are many, including years of underinvestment in aging infrastructure and growing transportation demand. In addition, gas tax revenues have failed to keep up with needs nationwide, for reasons that include increased fuel efficiency, alternative fuel vehicles, changes in travel patterns, and declining vehicle miles traveled nationwide. In addition, most states and the federal government have flat rate cents per gallon gas taxes that are the core source of revenues for transportation. So that means that every year, even if inflation and construction costs are going up, the same amount of cents is collected per gallon of gas sold year after year after year, which means that the purchasing power goes down. This is a chart that came out last December of how long it's been since each state increased its gas tax. There has been political reluctance nationwide and at the federal level to increase gas taxes. That recent report from which this data comes from the Institute on Taxation and Economic Policy says that after adjusting to account for growth in construction costs, the average state's gas tax has fallen by 20% since it was last increased, resulting in a nationwide drop of about $10 billion per year across the states. And often what small increases are enacted lag behind the funding needs. The value of the federal gas tax is falling as well. It's gone down by about a third since it was last increased in 1993. New York, however, is a bit of an exception because it's one of the 12 states that has any kind of variable rate tax connected to fuels, in this case, the petroleum business tax. This is a chart of what's going on with gas taxes just in the region. New York has the third highest combined gas tax and diesel tax in the nation, which is above national averages. The national recession and state budget shortfalls have also had an effect on transportation funding nationwide. Although the recession is improving and conditions are improving for states, state tax revenue collections tend to lag behind other indicators of economic recovery, and nationwide are still below pre-recession levels. Now, although transportation is mostly funded by dedicated revenue sources, the competing demands for overstretched state dollars mean that in many cases, those revenues for transportation are being moved elsewhere to plug other holes in state budgets. And finally, the uncertainty of the federal program. Although a 27-month bill was just signed into law in July, it doesn't solve the core problem of funding sustainability at the federal level, and thus states still don't know quite what to expect after that 27 months. So the trends nationwide are mixed. States are cutting transportation programs, and in more than half the states, road investments are below pre-recession levels. On the other hand, because there are dedicated revenues for transportation, transportation has drawn fewer state budget cuts in recent years than other program areas, and there has been, on average, growth in Department of Transportation budgets at the state level. The costs of underinvestment in transportation infrastructure are high. According to the American Society of Civil Engineers, most of America's transportation infrastructure is, on average, in mediocre or failing condition. And that deterioration is costing U.S. households and businesses nearly $130 billion each year in various costs and time delays. If current trends continue, the costs will increase to more than $200 billion each year in the next 8 years, and more than $500 billion each year by 2040, according to the Society. This has left states asking two questions. At the beginning of this year, states really wanted to know if Congress would enact long-term funding and policy for surface transportation. The answer is, well, it depends on what you mean by long-term. But we would say yes to an extent, but concerns still remain about that core issue of sustainable funding. But having said that, states are also looking at, well, how are we going to provide and fund and finance transportation infrastructure with or without those long-term sustainable federal programs? The options that states have before them include funding, which is increasing or creating new money coming in, financing, so leveraging or borrowing against the money that states have, and efforts to be efficient, accountable, and to make sure that revenues are going where they're meant to go. And we'll be getting to public-private partnerships in a little bit more detail under financing. This is just a list of all of the funding sources or revenue sources that states are using for roads, bridges, rail, and transit. You can see there's a pretty large list there. And New York uses many of these. We have fuel taxes, sales taxes on fuel, motor vehicle or rental car sales taxes, various fees, tolls, general funds, interest income, and other sources like lotteries and gaming, and dedicated revenue from general sales taxes. Then we get into financing. So if we're living in a time of finite resources and limited revenues, how are states borrowing against or otherwise leveraging state revenues for surface transportation projects? This is a list of many of the tools that states have used, including very familiar things like state bonds, also federal credit assistance, state infrastructure banks, design-build, which NCSL counts separately from more advanced or more involved public-private partnerships, and then public-private partnerships themselves, which, as of July, were authorized in 33 states and Puerto Rico. Public-private partnerships, when I'm talking about them, when we talk about them, refer to more than a dozen contractual agreements that can be formed between public and private sector partners, which allow more private sector participation than is traditional. And this USDOT definition includes governments contracting with private companies to renovate, construct, operate, maintain, or manage a facility or system. PPPs can include innovative contracting, project delivery, and financing arrangements. Not all of them include financing, but they certainly can, between public and private sector partners, where the private sector takes on functions that were traditionally the role of government or the state. PPPs have many potential advantages if done well. And this will be talked about in more detail by some of the other speakers that I'm proud to precede today. They can include helping to complete large-scale transportation projects by bringing in additional money to leverage, as well as the cost savings, efficiencies, economies of scale and scope, which we heard about, that result from this approach. But having said that, if you remember only one thing that I say standing up here today, it's the distinction between funding and finance. Often people think that public-private partnerships are going to bring in a huge amount of private sector money, and that it's just going to come in for free, just a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. And just like a credit card isn't the same as a paycheck, this isn't the same as funding. Public-private partnerships mean that the private sector still needs to make a return on their investment. And often they do that from the same sources of revenue that the state would otherwise have used, such as taxes, tolls, or fees. So that revenue goes to the private sector if it's a revenue-generating project, and it may not go to the state. So PPPs themselves have many potential advantages, but they're not a source of free money. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the state governmental roles related to PPP decision-making, as well as some of the elements that have been in laws that have been enacted in states across the country. States in America are primarily responsible for PPP policy and implementation decisions, as opposed to some other countries where that's been centralized at the federal level. Both the legislature and the executive branch, departments of transportation, governors, have roles for PPPs. The legislature, of course, creates the policy framework and in some states has to approve specific projects. The executive branch implements those projects within the legislative guidelines with all that that entails, including programs, projects, contracting, and oversight. And then there are many areas where the two branches of government overlap in their roles, including building public sector capacity to be able to do these well, supporting and funding project analyses, engaging in outreach, and selecting and approving projects. This is the map of where PPP-enabling statutes are currently in place. As I said, 33 states in Puerto Rico now allow public-private partnerships for roads or bridges. This doesn't include those states that have legislation just around transit systems. The most recently enacted was Pennsylvania, which just had their bill signed into law on July 5th. And you can see that there's a variety of statutes, including those that are very broad, those that only enable a certain number of projects or specifically identified projects, and many, many states which have no legislation at all. NCSL in our research has always advised that solid, balanced, and comprehensive state-enabling legislation is the key to thorough consideration of PPP proposals and protection of the public interest. PPPs continue to be an area of interest across the states. This is a map of which states looked at or considered any legislation related to PPPs this year. Now, keep in mind that these aren't all pro-PPP bills. Some of these were to revoke or rescind authority. And right now we're looking at, we know of at least 18 states and 37 bills, including a few in New York that are specific to MTA, the Bridge Authority, and the Thruway Authority, that are pending. Let's talk about a few of the key provisions that we've looked at NCSL. And some of these are, including these, legislative approval requirements can be quite contentious. These are looking at the states that require the legislature to enact in some way approval for some or all public-private partnership projects. So there will already be a general law in place, and then the legislature has to act to approve particular projects. This is controversial because those who want to move projects forward are concerned that that creates another barrier before you can engage in a project. On the other hand, perhaps some people who are more concerned about projects running away with themselves want that extra stop to protect the public interest. So there's been a lot of strong feelings on both sides of this issue. Currently, there are 9 states that require approval for some or all projects. There are states that require approval only to convert existing roads to privately operated toll roads. There are states that involve the legislature in review or giving feedback, but not actually having to approve a project. And then the rest of them have no formal legislative requirements at all. Pennsylvania, which as I said, just enacted their law, has an interesting model because the legislature can block projects for state-owned facilities only, but must approve projects for the turnpike only. And that's an interesting issue because in Pennsylvania, PPP issues got very tied to the turnpike at one point in their history, and that involves some controversy. And so now that is the one area in the law that requires legislative approval. These are some of the other key legislative provisions: public input and engagement, public sector analyses, requiring the state to compare PPPs, for example, to public procurement to really see which one is more advantageous to the state in the case of specific projects, and public PPP advisory bodies, which were created in law in both California and Puerto Rico to provide expertise and guidance. I will say that there are more, we have found, just ourselves, more than 40 different types of provisions in laws across the states. These laws do not look the same. There are lots and lots of differences. So it's not just things like this, but issues related to labor and state employees, related to environmental protections, related to procurement, related to everything that you can think of, truly, funding and finance, how toll rates are going to be set. They vary widely across the states. We're currently engaged in an analysis of all the existing laws by 40 different factors, which I would have loved to have for you today. We hope to have that done by the end of the year, but if anyone has questions about that level of detail after the presentation, I would be happy to give you my card and send you whatever you need. For the rest of my presentation, I'm going to talk briefly about our partners project at NCSL that we had up until December of last year and some of the general principles that came out of the combined wisdom of that group. We created the group in 2008 due to intense legislative interest in PPPs, given the legislative role in making them happen and the potential benefits in a time of limited resources. The project linked legislators, legislative staff, and private sector entities to analyze legislators' needs and develop nonpartisan, balanced, useful, and reliable materials to aid legislators' decision-making as they were exploring specifically public-private partnerships in transportation. We focused on publicly held surface transportation, especially roadways, more than, say, rail or transit. And we held workshops, we wrote books, and we provided technical assistance upon invitation in state houses across the country. The group did expire last December, but our activities continue. And this is just a few of the people who were involved in the Partners Project. You see legislators from several states, legislative staff, and a large number of association and private sector partners. Everything from the Reason Foundation to the unions were involved in our project. And so the principles I'm about to share with you from that were agreed upon by the entire gamut, nonpartisan, across the gamut of people who are interested in this issue and have a stake in it. And what I'm going to talk about in terms of the principles, all of this is fleshed out, and a lot of what I've talked about is fleshed out in more depth in this book that came out in 2010, which is available for free online, and there will be a flyer uploaded later on, I understand, on an available website that will have links to this, but it's also easy to find on our website or through me. So what are our principles, our general principles for decision-making about moving in to PPPs and PPP legislation? Number one is to be informed, to make sure that there's adequate access to fact-based information. Principle number two is to separate the debates. We saw nationwide, and our members in the Partners Project mentioned several cases where the debates about whether a state should allow the PPP approach generally got tangled up with issues such as tolling, taxes, or very specific projects. And although that can in some cases help move PPP legislation along if there's a lot of support for a particular project, our folks generally agreed that keeping those things distinct can create a lot of clarity around talking about PPPs. Consider the public interest for all stakeholders, everyone who will be affected. Involve and educate stakeholders early and often to help protect the public interest, improve buy-in, and mitigate political risk. Take a long-term perspective because PPPs are long-term, particularly when looking at, say, trading long-term incoming revenues for a short-term upfront payment. It really has to be thought through as to whether or not that will be the best approach in a given situation. Let the transportation program drive PPP projects, not the other way around. This is important that PPP should be used as one tool in the toolbox to support a state's overall transportation strategy and really the business of getting people where they want to go, as opposed to just raise short-term revenue. Support comprehensive project analyses to be sure that PPPs are indeed a better option in any given situation than traditional project delivery. Be clear and transparent about the financial issues, and set good ground rules for bidding and negotiations. And I will say that we've seen that since this report came out in 2010, we've seen a lot of trends in all of these directions. There are historical examples where not all of these things perhaps were done, and some of those are drawn out in our report. But these are just our general principles for making these decisions based on lessons learned from the wisdom of our partners. NCSL will be continuing to provide technical assistance, education, and meetings, as well as that analysis that I spoke about, if anyone is interested in more of what we do for legislatures across the country. And I understand we're going to have a few moments for questions, and then a longer time for all of us to answer questions. So should I just stay up here, Jim?
If I can interrupt, okay. It may be good, starting with the mayor, to go around, allow everybody to introduce themselves. So I know we have a lot of important guests who have taken time out of their schedules, and I'm appreciative of that. And then maybe shoot the question, and we can keep a tally, and unless we just want to, I'll let you guys figure it out. But let's do that.
Thanks a lot, Jamie.
Thank
let's
you.
Give her a round of applause.
Hi, I'm former Mayor Joseph Delfino, City of White Plains. Went through the renaissance of our city for 12 years, left office, decided to leave office in 2010. But I'm happy to be here and support Senator Ball and this PPP proposal.
Thank you so much, Mayor.
Any questions?
Name and organization. Do you want to?
Vincent Altieri, Rockland County Highway Department. The county executive has long supported the use of PPPs for the TZB project.
Peter Chris, president of Phoenix Marketing and president of the Pauling Chamber of Commerce. I've had the privilege of working with the senator through the years on a number of different projects. We welcome his initiative here and welcome the opportunity to work with everyone in the room as we move forward with New York State.
Thank you very much.
Joe Ferrara, I'm the vice president of Rail Transit with KS Engineers, it's a consulting firm. I'm a former chief engineer at the Long Island Railroad and worked a lot with Metro North on trying to put rail on the Tappan Zee Bridge. So I'm a big proponent of that, and I'm here fully to support that and support the PPP concept. I think it's a great idea, and I'm looking forward to see its success for Senator Ball.
Thank you. Joe Burkita, I'm the chief administrative officer of Yonkers Public Schools. We are at the very beginning stages of a P3 project, a $1.7 billion educational facilities plan. We're in the feasibility study phase right now, and very interested to see the kind of legislation we can put together. And if I don't get another chance, I'd like to tell you that a part of the feasibility study will be to tell us what kind of legislative changes we might need, and I'd be happy to share that with you when we get those results.
Great.
Move
this forward.
Thank you.
Ross Pepe, I'm president of Construction Industry Council of Westchester and Hudson Valley and the Building Contractors Association of Westchester and Mid-Hudson. We have a great interest in private-public partnerships and how it will center about the public infrastructure renewal as well as any other facility renewals that municipal governments and state government need to advance over the next decades.
Vishnu Patel, Yorktown Councilman. I've been in the politics for 2.5 years, and I'm learning it, and I'm sharing all my information with everybody I know. Thank you.
Dave Paganelli, Yorktown Councilman. We see the need for alternative forms of finance with revenues falling, and we think this is a wonderful opportunity to move into the future. Commend.
Let me just say
one quick
thing before we go any further. Thanks a lot.
No, don't interrupt me again.
No, I'm sorry about that.
No, go ahead.
Okay. We do have a guest speaker that's got a tight time frame. He's got to get out. So if everyone could keep it to their name and their organization so that we can make sure that you all get the value of these experts up here.
Okay, Jim, telling me to keep it moving. I got it.
Cutting it at you.
I'm Cindy Rubino. I'm the vice chair of the Government Action Council for the Business Council of Westchester.
John Ravitz, Business Council of Westchester.
Mike Shalero, Director of Commercial Lending for Community Mutual Savings Bank. Also a councilman in North Castle and a director on the board of the Business Council.
Kim Azzarelli, I'm an assembly candidate for the 95th District, which includes the river towns of Ossining, Briarcliff, Cortland, Peekskill, and Phillipstown.
Alan Burkson, I'm a principal at the Intelligence School.
Norm Michaels, president of Michaels & Associates, member of the Board of Directors of the Business Council, and a member of the Government Action Committee.
Bill Noll, Putnam County Chambers of Commerce.
Hi, I'm Marcia Earle. I'm a senior vice president with HDR Engineering. We are an employee-owned engineering consulting company.
Jessica Jamroz, I'm an associate at Frederick Schwartz Architects. We're an architecture and planning firm. We designed the Westchester County 9/11 Memorial.
Russell Goff, Patterson Highway Superintendent.
Stan Polinski with Geod Corporation, surveying, mapping, and engineering firm.
Dwight McLeod, Capstone Strategy Group.
Hugh Marriott, Chief Executive Officer of a facilities management company called In Service Enterprise.
Eileen Miltenberger, representing the County of Westchester Executive's Office, Rob Astorino.
Jonathan Schneider, Councilman for the Town of Carmel.
Tom Iannicarry, broker for the Reese Insurance Group.
Keith Thompson with Kiewit Infrastructure Co., we're a local contractor.
Eric Morrissey, Pace University.
Wiley Harrison with the Business Council of Westchester.
Laura Sinitsky, I'm Director of Development for Richmond Community Services.
Joff, I'm also with the Federal Highway Administration.
Joseph Fong, I'm an intern for County Legislator Peter Harkham.
Wendy Wild, here representing our County Legislator and Majority Leader Peter Harkham.
Lee Roberts, the supervisor of Bedford.
Mark Pollock, vice president with Lochner Engineering.
Alexander Chansey, president of DAC Consulting, cost estimating firm.
Leo Fabio, president of Elect Construction Services, based in Washington.
Peter Richard, superintendent of Highway Town Lewis Farm.
Heather Coffey, Melkers Contracting Company. We're a general contractor to the Public Works Heavy Civil Construction.
Deborah Patterson with Con Edison.
I'm Mark Ledger with the firm Harris Beach. I'm currently the acting corporation counsel for the city of Beeson.
Paul Albert, chairman of Albert Investments, and also on Senator Bull's Tax and Economic Development Committee.
Sue Tischler, Women's Enterprise Development Center.
Mike Simone, Town of Carmel Highway Superintendent.
Terry Kirshner, Westchester Library System.
George Miller, partner in the law firm of Mayor Brown.
Sarah Morris with Tudor Pretty.
Warren Lucas, supervisor, North South.
I nearly ran you over in Crow Falls.
Is that you?
Yeah.
The cops going after you.
John Jordan, managing editor of Construction Unit.
Neil Rentz, assistant editor of the Examiner newspaper.
Boston Christian, associate vice president at the Rowdy Engineering at Lanza Bay.
I'm Alex Blanc from Stagner Realty.
AJ Janissari, CDM Smith, consultant firm.
Okay. Thank you all so much. Our next guest panelist is Zhang Li. Zhang Li is the Associate Director for Finance and Business Development at the American Association of State Highway and Transportation Officials. In that role, he reviews surface transportation policy and legislative matters with state transportation departments, congressional staff, and at the executive branch. We would like to have Zhang to come up and to give us his presentation. Give him this round of applause.
All right, thank you very much. Thank you, Senator. Thank you, Assemblyman. Thank you, former Assemblyman and the distinguished guests. I'm really pleased to be here, first time in Mount Kisco, and also happy to see a lot of close colleagues in the industry that we've had many opportunities to work together on this and kind of the broader transportation issues at the national and state level. So my presentation is really going to serve as a compliment, I think, to the excellent layout that Jamie had on the issue of public-private partnership, especially as it pertains to transportation. So I'll do a little bit more context setting in terms of what the investment scenarios are like right now in terms of the needs and the potential solutions that are out there, and also talk specifically about the public-private partnership approach, and then also maybe do a little bit of a glossing over of various activities when it comes to the application of P3s around the United States. So as Jamie mentioned, we are experiencing a severe investment shortfall when it comes to transportation infrastructure in the United States. There were two congressionally chartered commissions a few years ago, both of which said that we need to invest generally about at least $200 billion. That's just on the capital side of investments, not operations and maintenance. Every single year, one of the commissions noted that that needs to happen every year for the next 50 years, and that we're spending about $90 billion right now. So very severe investment shortfall. And when you're looking at the different infrastructure sectors as well, this isn't limited to, say, just highways versus just transit. This really does affect, when you think about infrastructure ranging from transportation, but also on surface side, but aviation side, on the waters, ports as well. And as you can see in this particular chart, the gaps are especially significant on the highway side because it is really, covers all parts of the country. And then on the energy sector as well, but especially in larger urban areas, obviously the mass transit deficit impact is also quite significant. And trying to put this in a little bit of the overall budgetary context, especially as part of the gross domestic product in this country, if you look at this particular chart, especially starting in 1956, that's when the interstate era officially began, there was a lot of construction of what resulted in 45, 47,000 miles of interstate system that we are proud to have built over the last 60 years. But the amount of investment in highways and transit since has trailed off a little bit and at best really stagnated. And, perhaps the comparison isn't quite apples to apples, but you hear about China investing substantial portions of GDP to the tune of 8 to 10% in infrastructure. And what we're experiencing here is, less than 1.5% for transportation. Yes, they're trying to catch up, but at the same time, in order to preserve our lead in infrastructure performance and condition compared to other countries in the world, we have to do a better job. And as Jamie hit upon this, this affects the fuel tax collections at the state level and at the federal level as well, and especially at the federal level, the gas tax and the diesel tax really are the most predominant forms of funding for surface transportation in the form of the Highway Trust Fund, which actually covers not just highways but mass transit activities as well. And because, as Jamie mentioned, this is a flat excise tax on per gallon purchased, unlike a sales tax in which you pay taxes on the proportion to the price, when fuel prices go up, gas tax does not go up. It's 18.4 cents per gallon at the federal level, whether gas is 90 cents a gallon or $4 a gallon. And at just the impact of inflation alone, and this is a fairly conservative estimate, as Jamie mentioned, at the federal level, the gas tax has lost its purchasing power by about a third at this point. If you look at it next 10 years, it will have lost more than half of the purchasing power. And just another way to frame this is that the gas tax at the federal level of 18.4 cents per gallon, just to maintain the original purchasing power back in 1993, today, it would have to be about 28, 29 cents per gallon, which would actually bring in about $18-plus billion in additional revenue that we do not get, again, because of the flat nature of the gas tax. And what this particular chart shows is that the federal surface transportation program is experiencing some serious cash deficits or constraints that leads to challenges in being able to sustainably fund the federal transportation program. And I keep talking about the federal transportation program because it's the federal highway and transit programs that provide 50% of capital program funding in the United States. The rest are then made up by the state and local partners. And the Highway Trust Fund has not been doing so well lately. Since 2008, it had to have infusions of general funds, which by being set up as a trust fund wasn't really meant to have to rely on sources other than fuel taxes and other special user fees. And so what this chart shows is that based on the current pace, the Highway Trust Fund will spend about $10 to $12 billion more every single year, as represented by the line above, compared to the money that's going to come into the Highway Trust Fund every single year. As anyone with a checking account can attest, this is not a sustainable pattern. And more specifically, the Federal Highway Program has been at about $40 billion in recent years, which, as I mentioned earlier, still is nowhere near meeting the needs of infrastructure investment. That program, if the current trajectory continues, absent any revenue measures, whether it be more general fund transfers or any enactment of new revenue measures at the federal level, the program will experience a substantial drop when the current surface transportation legislation that just passed expires in September of 2014. We're estimating at this early stage that we'll see about a $35 billion drop in the federal highway program, about an $8 billion drop in the federal transit program as well. This is an absolutely devastating scenario that nobody wants to see happen. So then what are the solutions? These are various revenue mechanisms that are technically feasible that we at AASHTO, the Association of All the State Transportation Departments, have asked the U.S. Congress to consider. And it ranges anywhere from indexing the gas tax, for example, for inflation, perhaps enacting some rate changes on the gas tax, but also various fees and charges on freight activities, registration fees, and the like. And the purpose of this chart, which you don't really have to know the details, is that illustratively speaking, there is no shortage of potential funding options that are out there, but the challenge has been on the political side, being able to persuade the constituents around the country that if you're willing to pay more, this is what you'll get in terms of a specific beneficial infrastructure investments. So as Jamie mentioned, one of the promising alternatives to just relying only on revenues and the funding and the pay-as-you-go program approach, which has been the hallmark of traditional public sector transportation investment in this country, is this public-private partnership model. And at AASHTO, we take the same stance as NCSL in that P3s provide potentially a very useful tool in among multitude of tools in the toolbox. We do not particularly advocate one funding or financing method over another. We really, you know, respect each of the state and localities' decisions to appropriately mix and package whatever best suits their unique needs. So looking at public-private partnership option, I mean, it can really range anywhere from the traditional design, bid, build procurement, which is what state transportation departments have relied on for 100 years. But it can get a little more creative and innovative in terms of by going through the P3 option. Do you package the design and build process? Do you package design, build, but also have the private sector financing? Do you let the private sector also operate the facility and maintain the facility? The spectrum of P3s, I think, it can be quite varied, and the potential for it to apply appropriately to a particular situation is where its potential strength lies. And once again, to back what Jamie has said, if also I can just leave one thing with me today is to make sure the distinction between the funding versus the financing is really delivered in that the revenue measures are where we're having a lot of tough times, again, in the form of increases, say, in taxes or user fees, whether it's at the federal level or at the state level. And the P3 option, while it could induce more private sector capital to come into infrastructure, again, because they are expecting a return on investment, that the same kinds of user fee and tax base that the public sector could keep on their own might have to be provided to your private sector partner in order for them to carry out some of the duties that perhaps the public sector has carried out for a long time. And when you're looking at, well, okay, so we have so and so many projects. What are the ones that are really applicable for this particular P3 type of arrangement and delivery? And this chart is maybe a little more busy than it needs to be, but if you really just focus on the pyramid there, what this shows is that really most of the projects that are not really complex or could really benefit from risk transfer, whether it's time delay, cost delay, and the like that the P3 model could alleviate, can really belong at the base of the pyramid here. And I'm also talking about, say, you know, low-volume roads and bridges that if you put a toll on it, it's really not going to make much of a difference in terms of the revenue picture. Those generally have will still have to rely on the kind of the traditional public-funded approach. And then you have some projects that are in the middle of the pyramid there that does have some revenue potential, but perhaps maybe it's not nearly as strong as some of the really, you know, busy urban expressway, for example. So it could require some sort of, you know, light touch from the government in terms of credit assistance and various financing programs. And then you have at the very top of the pyramid, you have really just absolutely marketable projects that will be able to sustain itself from various revenues that it can generate, whether, again, it's tolls or similar types of user fees. And what this pyramid is really trying to tell you is that the applicable pool of projects for P3s is more limited than the projects that, you know, will absolutely not work with the P3 approach. So you have to be careful about what are the kinds of, you know, larger projects, more complex projects that you might want to consider for P3s. Because another aspect of P3s is that there is a significant transaction cost that is associated with, you know, getting your financing and legal advisors lined up that you might not have to do for the traditional public procurement. There is also a lot of negotiations in terms of not trying to craft a perfect contract per se, but at least a very balanced and carefully thought out contract that requires a lot of thinking, a lot of input of resources and things like that. So the cost of project development for P3s tends to favor the more larger, say, $500 million plus highway projects and transit projects. And that's generally been the experience in other countries around the world as well. You look at the private finance initiative in the United Kingdom. They've kind of gone on a trajectory where they're doing perhaps fewer projects, but each project is much larger in magnitude on average. So just looking at the P3 activities in perspective in the United States, a lot of activities has really focused around on the transportation side, on the highway side, although increasingly we're seeing more on the transit side. And then a lot of the social infrastructure project has also taken place as well as the water and wastewater type projects. So you can see that there has been, you know, a smattering of various activities in different sectors of infrastructure. When you look at some of the more perhaps avant-garde P3 approaches where you rely more on the public private sector role, this concession type approach, we've seen about 11 projects worth $12 billion. And then some have gone even further than that and been really asset privatizations, which isn't even a public-private partnership, but more of a you know, full privatization worth about $7 billion. And this is an interesting point to note on the third bullet here. With all the P3 activities that have taken place, as I mentioned, between 1989 and 2011, the capital investment just on the highway side covered by P3s has really been about 2% of total investment. So I think that gives you a couple of ideas here. One is that there's a lot of potential for increased application of P3s. But also, to caveat is that, you know, there are only so many projects in which the P3 approach has been favorable for. But when you look at especially a lot of the Sunbelt states like Florida and Texas that has a lot of growth, a lot of new highway capacity, for example, has relied on the P3 approach. And having spoken to some of the, you know, Wall Street types, they say that, you know, they're expecting to see maybe 2 to 4 significant deals when it comes to P3s and transportation a year. Perhaps that could change. And what AASHTO's position, again, this is the group of state transportation departments, is that we would like to see, if not more funding from federal government, naturally we would love to see more funding, but also just more flexibility in terms of what kind of approaches and tools that the states can use. And this is covering both kind of the conventional methods, whether it's funding or financing through various forms of traditional municipal debt, for example, but also really innovative approaches that perhaps haven't been done before, but with help of the federal government could really see some good success. And related to that is, you know, increasing the use, allowing the increased use of public-private partnership opportunities, and that can really bring in the management efficiency potential and the innovation potential of the private sector, but then really pair that up with the traditional public sector responsibilities about, you know, social equity and job generation and the like. And what we've been asking Congress to do is that, you know, whenever there are potential barriers to implementation of creative ideas, some in the form of P3s, that, you know, we'd like to see those barriers limited or removed to the extent possible. So thank you again very much for this opportunity, and I look forward to the question and answer panel later on.
We will now have our next guest to come up, Richard Normant. Richard is the Executive Director for the National Council for Public-Private Partnerships. Our first two experts have really put their focus in the area of transportation. Richard's going to discuss more of the social infrastructure. So if you're a local municipality, we've got some supervisors in the room and with the counties to talk about the various buildings and facilities. Richard's going to be the one that's going to give us some ideas in that area. Let me pull his presentation up. Richard. Sorry about that. That's not you. Okay, we're almost there. Sit tight, you all.
It's kind of tough following these two because they did half of my presentation. Which is going to make it easy because then I can skim through that and get to what I think probably really is relevant, particularly, Senator, from the standpoint of what kind of features and factors should there be in the legislation to make it successful. And I think, as you've heard repeatedly, this is not an easy process. It's more difficult than your standard design, bid, build, which everybody's been using for the last maybe 100 years. But partnerships are actually a lot. Where is the down? Oh, there it is. Okay.
Got it. Okay.
All right. We've heard enough of this about the financial crunch and the needs. NCPPP is a little bit different than these two groups here. Jamie and Jung, they've got their membership that are made up almost exclusively of the public sector. We're a combination of both public and private, but the common denominator being we're promoting the concept of use of public-private partnerships where appropriate. I'm going to differ a little bit with Jung's 2% number. The reason it's only 2% is to some extent, just like New York, you don't have the statute in place to facilitate partnerships. We generally have seen analyses, our own work, elsewhere in the world, up to 15% of projects could be done as PPPs. Not all of them. You're both correct there. They don't fit everywhere. But that 15%, particularly when you start getting into consideration of things, not just transportation, but getting into the social infrastructure thing that Jim just referenced. One other thing, I've been on a personal crusade ever since I joined NCPPP 12 years ago. We are not talking about privatization. Press, I know there's some press in the room. This is not meant as a rock being thrown at you. It happens in legislations, it happens in legislators, and it happens everywhere. Confusing the term of public-private partnership with privatization. Privatization is when the asset is turned over to the private sector, sold, whatever the case might be, and there's minimal public control. In a partnership, the public stays as an active part of the process. They're a partner. So that public officials have some control over what's happening in Yonkers, in the school district, or whatever. You know, it's a very important distinction between public-private partnerships and privatization. It's not a revolutionary idea. I unfortunately was trained as a historian, so I will not launch into the 45-minute lecture on the history of public-private partnerships, but they go back 300 years. First ones were in transportation, but Boston's water system was built by a private company 250 years ago. Some of the pipes are still in the ground. Point is that we are just now beginning to shift away from heavy reliance solely on the public sector to more reliance on the private sector. We've got some catching up to do. I mean, you know, I make reference here to used in Europe, Asia, Latin America. In many cases, particularly in Europe, and we'll hear a little bit later on about what's going on in Europe, they've been more aggressive about the use of public-private partnerships. The funny thing is, the one country that has more public-private partnerships than anywhere else in the world, even if you count all of the European Union as one country, there are more of them in India. They have found a way to develop these things, harness private capital, harness private resources to develop all kinds of projects, not just roads, all kinds of projects. Definition, it's a contract between a public agency and a private sector entity. By that, I mean it can be more than one company on the private sector side, and there usually is more than one. For those of you who are from the private sector, we're not necessarily talking about dipping into your own corporate pockets to do a public-private partnership. I heard the governor's comment about being the capital of capital. There are all these guys sitting down there in Manhattan. I've got one of our members who told me he's got $5 billion in his right-hand drawer just looking for a place to invest. That's one guy. There's lots of money out there, and it's coming from not just your traditional investment houses, but also from pension funds. That has been the biggest player that's been added to the game in the last couple of years. But the secret in this is you're sharing the assets and skills, also sharing risks and rewards. And it takes, it takes a bit of a while to work out a contract that includes all of that. But we're using partnerships now in transportation, water, urban development, a whole range of things. The concept fits not just for horizontal roads, transit systems, but for any place where you're talking about an infrastructure and sometimes social services. Westchester County has a, for elderly and aging, they've got a public-private partnership that has been very successful over the last couple of years of bringing resources from a variety of sources together, done on an ad hoc basis because they don't have the statutory environment, but still it's working. Point in a partnership is that the private sector has refined some skills and techniques through competition in the marketplace. Public sector doesn't have competition. If it succeeds or fails, yeah, okay, you've got the voting block, the voting box. Public can give you a thumbs up or thumbs down vote. In private sector, if the customer stops buying your product, you go out of business, and it can be very quick that that happens. My wife was raised in Rochester, New York, which used to be known as the home of Kodak. What's happened to Kodak in the last couple of years? Unfortunately, the biggest mistake they ever made was they invented the digital camera, then gave it away. Our business is making film. All right, your business is drying up and gone, and Kodak is unfortunately withering and just about done now because their customer base didn't respond. You've got to change and adapt to the customer base. And private sector is very good at doing that. The question is, in a partnership, do you make the project something where you're dealing with a customer base, where you've got to be efficient in delivery and meeting the customer's needs, meeting the public services? All right. Private sector, they may have a lot of resources and skills, et cetera, but you cannot do a public-private partnership without the public sector. I hate to tell you how many times I get called by companies to say, well, can we start a public-private partnership without the public sector's approval? No. The public, that's why we call them a public-private partnership. It's initiated by the public. The public sector has to do a lot of groundwork before it even issues that request for proposal. We're in the process of writing a white paper now, which will be available hopefully within the next 30 days, on what are the steps that the public sector should go through in making an evaluation, do we want to do a public-private partnership? It has to do with evaluations of value for money, public sector comparators, a whole variety of factors. It's from the standpoint of the people here from the public sector, I'm not asking you to do these evaluations, but get your staff to do them. It should be in the legislation. It is in the Texas bills for their social infrastructure that you've got to do a value for money evaluation. What would it cost the public sector to do this solely on its own, come up with a number, make sure you've got the full life cycle cost analysis, all the factors tied in there. Then you've got a yardstick to compare the private sector bid. Sometimes the private sector will do better, sometimes not. Secret is balancing these two factors. And one thing that I was asked to touch on here, partnerships, the most active arena, and Jern kind of pointed it out. When you looked at the number of partnerships that he had there, okay, there's so many for transportation. And they get all the press. Tappan Zee Bridge, if it's done as a public-private partnership, will be a very big number, which the press locks in on. $9 billion will get your attention. What doesn't get people's attention is the $10 million parking lot or the $40 million school or the $150 million water system, all of which are being done by public-private partnerships. It doesn't get into the press because it's not that big number. We are constantly, our website has a whole listing of case studies illustrating where these have been used in a wide variety. What I've also been asked to do on a number of occasions, I've worked with the state of Maryland on drafting some legislation. They looked at Virginia's statute. And Senator and Assemblyman, keep this in mind. Virginia may have a right to work environment. Maryland does not. Maryland is very much the standard, just like New York State, what's prevailing wage. The point is what they've done and what they are doing, because this legislation will finally get passed in January, they got it through both chambers, Senate, Assembly. Unfortunately, the Assembly modified a few things here, and they ran out of time before they could get to a reconciliation of the two bills. But take what works out of either the Texas or the Virginia statutes or California statutes and adapt them to fit to the New York situation. There's plenty of examples out there, and Jamie's got them. We can lead you to a whole variety of different sources as to what does work. But there's one thing I do want to touch on, which, again, should be reflected. Jim, are you going to have these on a website or something available, or they're on ours?
Absolutely, yeah. And on Senator Ball's website.
Okay. And the thing I passed out's got our website listed on it. All of this stuff is available there about what are the advantages of, et cetera, et cetera. But let me get to one thing that I think, actually seven things that I think are critical to understand that should be reflected in the legislation. Seven things that need to be in place for a successful public-private partnership. First, you've got to have a public sector champion. If it's a local transportation project or a local water project or a school project, whatever it is, you have to have somebody who has credibility with the general public and the ability to influence the public sector workforce. Change how they do things. There's got to be somebody who's going to be willing to be the spokesperson and the leader, the champion on this, and generally, it's got to be from the public sector. There's no exception to that. Secondly, this is what we're all talking about. You've got to have a statutory environment that will induce the agencies to have a tool to work with, provide a framework. First and foremost, which agencies have authority? Is it just New York DOT, or are you getting into broader? And what some states have done is they've said, okay, here's a framework, a model to follow. If you, at the county level, city level, adopt this open, transparent procurement policy, go ahead and do it. Don't bother coming back to Albany. That, I think, is a very powerful tool. You provide a clear framework and structure for them within which to operate. We can give you plenty of examples of that. What frequently has been the case is that there are procurement statutes available, and there are in New York State, but you've got, it's like the Chinese menu. take one from column A, one from column B, and next thing you have all this patchwork of things that you have to put together to be able to execute a public-private partnership. And I bet you that's what you're running into in Yonkers. If there's a clear statute that says, okay, we're taking existing code from various places and pulling it together into one unified model, that makes it much easier to execute a public-private partnership. That's critical.
Okay.
This one gets a little tougher. Award contracts on the basis of best value, not lowest price. Which means, what's this going to cost you over the next 10, 20 years? Maybe it costs a little bit more at the front end, but when you get to year 5, 10, 20, the end goal is a savings in the long run. So best value, not lowest price, is something that statutorily should be allowed for. That means that the public sector's got to do the analysis and the evaluation to justify what is best value. One other question that's going to pop up, and I've seen this crop up. I remember years ago I had Secretary of Transportation from North Carolina asked me, do you have a good model for legislation for transportation partners? I said, yeah, well, look at the Virginia model. I don't want any of the unsolicited proposals. The mumbling he didn't mumble. He came up with some very clear language, rather expletives, of course. Unsolicited proposals are sometimes interpreted by people as this is putting unnecessary burden on the public sector. Wrong. A proposal is only generated when the private sector has been willing to invest the time and money, and these are substantial investments, when they know that there is a perceived need and maybe even a desire to do something, but the public sector can't figure out how to do it. My favorite example, I-495 in Virginia. Virginia Department of Transportation had for 10 years said, we know we got a problem. We got serious congestion. The way to solve the problem would be to expand the road by so many lanes, but we don't have the money. Can't do it. Well, an unsolicited proposal comes in and says, we got an idea for you. We'll put two lanes north and two lanes south on it, and we'll make those hot lanes. Having nothing to do with the temperature recently in Washington, but this is high occupancy toll. If you've got three people in the car, it's free. Two or less, hopefully at least one. The toll will vary depending on time of day, traffic demand. So that allows for a revenue stream that would help pay back, not help, which does pay back the private sector investment in this. End of the package is it's one-third state funds, one-third private funds, and one-third TIFIA. 2.3, something like that. It's over $2 billion project. But it's a blend. And part of it is being done on the basis of accepting an unsolicited proposal, and secondly, what's best value. Organized structure. This is key. And again, you may want to suggest this in the legislation. Texas did this, where they set up a state agency that administers the process from inception to final management of major projects. Now, what they've done is said, okay, if this is a project for the state, for a state facility, be it transportation, be it a university, if it's a state-owned property, they've got this agency set up that's going to manage it all the way through. If it's a municipal property, county, city, fine. Here's the format. Don't bug me. Go ahead and do it. Just follow these rules. But I think it's important for everybody to understand. I'm not talking loud enough?
No, you're talking loud.
Okay. You need to have within the public sector a group of people who understand what the process is and how to take it from concept all the way through to final management. Part of the problem is this is a new procurement process to most people. And what we strongly recommend is if the skill sets are not present in the public sector, retain some people. I see a nod coming from somebody over there who has been in the business of providing counsel and advice.
We're on the receiving end when people don't do that.
Yeah, exactly. But what happens is when you look at examples of TxDOT, VDOT, PPP Centrum, that's in Prague, in Czech Republic. What happens is initially there's a heavier demand for the use of consultants, lawyers, advisors, et cetera, but as the public sector gains experience, that cost declines. But you need the skill sets to do this properly. That should be allowed for in the legislation, legislative process. You've got to have a detailed business plan. We've got a lawyer here to talk to us about detailed business plans. My favorite one is one that was done for the Chicago Skyway, which you need a pickup truck to move it around. It's like 500 pages with four manuals, 10 inches thick, of just the addendums of performance standards. The important thing, though, is these contracts are performance-oriented, not design-oriented. Let the private sector design what's going to be the best answer. Public sector comes up and says, we need this kind of level of performance. We need a school that'll handle 500 students. Give me your best offer. We need a parking lot that'll handle, you know, pick up a number. And each one of these things, the private sector will come up with responses that sometimes people wouldn't have thought of before. That's why creativity and stuff, I mean, we can all talk about, remember when Ma Bell ran the phone company and then these things happened? Innovative approach comes out of competition in the marketplace. Harness that for the public good. And that's what this is all about. But it's got to be in the contract in the form of performance standards, not design standards. And that's a big change. Big change for the public sector. All right, I'm almost done. This is not philanthropy. You want that? Call the Gates family or whoever, you know. Last time I checked, Bill and Melinda could build a highway anywhere. I mean, they got money that's, you know, but they're not in the, this is not philanthropy. Structure the deal in such a way that there is a guaranteed revenue stream. Now, it could be tolls, user fees, it could be tax increment financing. If the real estate value in the adjacent area is going to go up, that becomes a very common tool for use in social infrastructure. Particularly if you tie it to a transportation project, you build a new interchange on a highway, also the local area there is going to develop. And we had one in Washington where they put a metro stop on an existing rail line. Property values went up 600% in 2 years. Using a TIF, that's a way to finance a big chunk of a project. Long-term management contracts, one of my favorite stories. Missouri still doesn't have public-private partnership legislation. Young's gone. The guy who used to head ASHTO, a guy by the name of Pete Ron, was Secretary of Transportation in Missouri, said, we've got 814 bridges that need to be replaced. We don't have a statute for public-private partnerships, so what we're going to do is we're going to use long-term maintenance contracts. He issued RFPs and said, here's a 20-mile stretch of road that you're going to manage for the next 20 years. You, private sector, so you're going to build it in such a way that your maintenance costs from year 2 to year 20 are going to be reduced substantially. Oh, by the way, there's a bridge in the middle of this road that's got to be replaced. But this is a long-term maintenance contract. He did 814 bridges that way. They even had a thing on their YouTube connection where they played the 1812 Overture with bridges being blown up, you know. Get clever. A former administrator of the Federal Transit Administration said, you've seen one public-private partnership, you've seen one public-private partnership. Each one of these has to be adapted to the local needs. But they do have to have a means for the private sector to recapture the capital. Not quite last. This is critical, particularly in the legislative process. There's a lot of misperception on many people about what a public-private partnership is. They need to have those myths demystified, clarified. This is not anti-labor. It's actually pro-jobs. It's not giving up public control and power to the private sector. No, the private sector is very much involved, but there needs to be a strong communication effort. Talking to the general public, the press, public employees, everybody understands, so they understand what the process is, because if they don't understand it, they could rapidly become opponents, and that becomes a process, a problem in the legislative process. Last but not least, pick your partners carefully. And this is where an open, transparent, competitive process is critical. And again, that's going to be in the statutory environment, I hope. My favorite example of this was years ago, I had a delegation from Mexico came in and asked, they wanted us to do a briefing on public-private partnerships, and we go through the whole thing, and said, yeah, yeah, yeah. A longer version than this. My record, by the way, is 18 hours on this one topic, so I'm really trying to compress it here today. Get to the end, and one of the people from the president's office said, well, we had a partnership in Tampico that didn't work out very well. So we talked a bit about it and everything else. The idea was pretty good. Pemex Oil needed a lot of water, so they wanted to build a water plant, and oh, by the way, they would subsidize it so that they could provide water at a lower income, a lower cost for the residents of Tampico. Conceptually, great idea. Execution didn't work out too well. Well, we go through the whole process and we find out, well, who was the company that did this? Did they have technical experience? No, they'd never built a water plant before. Did they have enough money to do this before the revenue stream started? No, they were pretty much broke. Well, how did they get picked? Was it an open, transparent, competitive process? No, it was the governor's brother-in-law. You got to have them pick your partners carefully. All of this is on our website, but critical in all of this stuff is public leadership, particularly when it gets to Albany. It's going to be on your shoulders, Senator, and as many allies and partners as you can find to get this through. I think the environment in New York is very favorable. I'm hearing some nice rumblings coming out of the governor's office. All right, you've got design-build legislation. That's the first 20% of this. What we're talking about is design, build, finance, operate, maintain. Get all that put together, you're 20% down the road, and Tappan Zee may push you the rest of the way. $7 billion, $9 billion, whatever it is. But in the process, I think it's critical. Keep in mind, this isn't just for transportation. It's for any kind of social infrastructure, any kind of public infrastructure. And I think I've gone on longer than you wanted me to, but anyhow.
I want to thank you. I do want to get into questions because I know there are a lot of people that have detailed questions. So I don't know if we want to go, you know, have Peter finish off and then.
Thank you very much, Richard. So we'll get to the next one. Come on up, Peter. Peter, you want to come on up? Peter Szewczynski just came in from Poland, and thank you so much for being able to stay for, I know we're a little bit over on our time, and I hope that you all can stay for this great presentation. Peter is an expert in PPP throughout the world, and he's got a lot of expertise in the area of financing, mostly in Eastern Europe, Central Europe, and we're going to have him to take us through his presentation. Then after that, we'll open up the floor to a host of different questions, both for the panelists as well as to Senator Ball and all of our guests. Thank you so much, Pete, for being here.
Thanks, Jim. Thank you very much, Senator, for inviting me. As you mentioned, I'm a partner at Squire Sanders. I really appreciate coming back here. I used to live in New York, but for more than 20 years, I've been working on infrastructure projects in Europe. So it's very good to be here and to talk about this. And rather than giving a sort of a macro view, I wanted to also give a micro view of a successful PPP project because you might be interested in how this works in real life. So which way is down?
This way right here.
Down there. Mm-hmm. Okay, great. So why do they work? An example of a successful project, key issues, and what to watch out for. They work because they can be on time, they can be on budget, and they meet performance standards. And it's important that we're talking about performance standards here and not necessarily just a project that's already been designed and to be constructed. Here is an example of the project that I worked on and am still working on for a very long time. This is a map of Europe. On the left, you'll see Germany. On the right, you'll see Russia. I can sort of analogize this to Rockland County on one side and Westchester County on the other with something needed to connect them. In the middle there's a big blank, and that shows the way the highway
network was built in Western Europe and was also developed in Eastern Europe. Why did this happen? Well, for those of you who are old enough to remember, really for geostrategic reasons. If you remember, there used to be something called a Cold War. And as part of that Cold War, there were American forces stationed in Western Europe and Germany. And what the Russians did, the Soviets, is that obviously there were highways, famous Autobahn, built in Germany. There were highways, motorways built in Russia and in Eastern Germany, when there was an Eastern Germany. But they created this area of 500 miles in between, which is where the U.S. tanks, when the war would start, they would get that far and then bog down in the bogs of Poland there with no highways to be able to cross, and that's where they were supposedly going to be destroyed by the Soviet forces. So that's why this is an area that you had with absolutely no infrastructure built in it. So the Polish government had this problem of trying to determine how actually to build that infrastructure after we changed from communism to capitalism. There was also a second very interesting thing that happened as a result of this 50 years or more of infrastructure development in Europe, and that's that there was a change in the migratory patterns of wild animals and birds, because they didn't want to keep on migrating in Western Europe where all that infrastructure used to be built up, but instead they had all of this non-infrastructure 500-mile stretch to go through. So you have seen a tremendous change in the migratory patterns of birds in Europe going through what is now Poland. That had tremendous environmental significance for building future infrastructure projects, and environmental aspects are a key point with regard to any infrastructure projects. So what happened? So on our A2 project, part of the Trans-European Network, which is the road from Berlin to Moscow, it has been built, the Polish government decided to do it in a P3 manner. And on the left, you'll see two portions of it. The one that's in red, which has been built in a P3 as phase two of the A2 project. And then the green part was built first. That was put into operation in 2000, the other one in 2009. The rest of the funding of what you can see there was actually funded entirely by effectively the federal government, the European Union, and not by the Polish government, so it was not done in a P3. And we're still looking to build that part to the east, to the Russian border where there's less traffic. How do you fund something like this, and what are the amounts involved? This project was one of the largest P3 projects in Europe. When it was under construction, there were several thousand persons working on this project. So this can be tremendous methods of job development, as well as economic development for the entire region. Put together, you have a project that's more than $3 billion in size, and it's relatively similar or analogous to what we've been talking about here in terms of its structures. We talk about the EIB, that's European Union, that's similar to TIFIA funding or infrastructure bank funding. We're talking about commercial lenders either coming in, commercial banks that do project financing, or a project bond structure. And then the equity portion that gets put into that. So those are the key elements in terms of a simplification of a project like this that can work. Project structure. When you're talking about this much money on a major infrastructure project, the P3 structure is complicated for something like this. Again, you have an analogous structure to the Federal Highway Fund. Here we had a National Road Fund that provides, so what you see on the top part of that is the state government or federal government, in this case, a structure as to the way its funding comes through. And at the bottom, a motorway concessionaire, a long-term concession contract that runs for 40 years in this case, and availability payments for part of it or real tolls on one of these sections. Putting that together is a lot of work and several, as you said, volumes of contracts and papers. What are some of the key issues that we should be looking at? What types of P3 agreements? Are they going to be concessions for what actions can be taken by the government? Who can execute them in terms of the authority? What's the procurement procedure? Are you following? Are you going to have a one-off or a consolidated one? As Richard said, that's another key issue. What are the payment subsidy mechanisms? What is the regulation of direct user charges? In other words, can that concession company make and determine what the user charges are going to be? Contract length. What are the turnover or buyback provisions? A key element is that at the end of the term, the government wants to get back a project that's functioning, not one that's deteriorated, but one that's basically done and ready to go and doesn't require renovation for many, many years to come. That's another one of the advantages of these projects. The performance security, and then revenue and profit sharing. What should we watch out for? We've discussed before the BFMO concept, where you can choose the full scope of the BFMO or the limited scope. Another term that's used in Europe is SGEI, Services of General Economic Interest, and this is just another formula for what we've talked about also before, that you have to make sure that the payments to the private party, to the operator, to the concessionaire, cover the payment of capital investment costs, the financing, the operating costs, the maintenance costs, plus a return on the investment. How can you pay for a project like that? Basically, these are simplifying four methods. Talking about transportation, real tolls, shadow tolls, availability payments, or subsidies. Allocating the risks, we've gone through this. From my point of view, permitting is a key issue because one of the key elements of putting together a P3 project ordinarily is the construction risk rests with the private party. That includes the permitting risk. Environmental archaeological risks can also be a big issue. You want to make sure that you have all those environmental permits done, working together with the public party to make sure that they're there. But in certain countries, you can dig up here, let's say, certain types of artifacts, whether they be Indian artifacts or Roman ruins, if we're going back far enough in Europe. Force majeure issues, change of law issues. If you have additional requirements where you're talking about a 40-year term, who's going to cover the risk that there's a law change? Because if you are expecting to get a rate of return based upon certain costs, and then you have to put in additional investment, who's going to be taking that risk? Failure of a party to perform is fairly obvious. Technological changes, we talk about roads, other type of schools, for instance, where you know that you want to make them available for students, you don't expect much change there. But if you're talking about telecommunications equipment or something like that, that industry, you're going to expect a lot of change. It's not necessarily as well adapted for a P3. And then who's taking the demand risk ultimately of how many users you're going to have? You have to have financial fairness. That's a key point between the public parties and the private parties. It cannot cause the private party to go bankrupt, mainly through the imposition of new requirements, additional costs that weren't set up at the beginning, or you cannot have an agreement that generates windfall profits. And windfall profits can come, for instance, through a refinancing arrangement where, putting it simply, if the initial financing was done at 8% and then you built the project and can refinance at a lower rate of interest, all of a sudden that private party could get windfall profits from something like that. You have to find a way to share that kind of profits in a project. Projects have to be assessed. What Richard's referred to, a value for money analysis is the term that's used right now. Doing that value for money analysis is something that's common and standard in the industry and needs to be incorporated, I think, in the viewpoint and analysis of this legislation. And then all the focus has to be on improving performance and availability. In summary, trying to do this quickly, want to make sure that what is a key issue is to have that accountability and transparency. The two of those factors equal legitimacy. And that legitimacy is a key issue, I think, in terms of the legislation, the standards that need to be adopted. And the point here is that a lot of the critics of 3 P's try to turn 3 P's into 4 P's. What's the fourth P? Prison or prosecutors. That you want to avoid, okay? And avoid those critics. Do that by making make sure that your legislation is accountable, transparent processes, make sure it's legitimate, and then you'll avoid the fourth P. Thank you.
Much, Peter. Senator Ball, we'll open it up. I do apologize for going over a little bit here. We've had some fantastic panelists, and we want to thank them for their participation. At this point, we'll open up the floor to any questions and feedback.
Are there any questions? Peter?
Senator, what's the next step? I mean, we're short on time here. We have some brilliant people on the panel.
First step is I need college credits after what I just listened to.
Right.
I've been through some tough classes in engineering at the Air Force Academy. That was intense. I'm telling you.
I think our question would be,
we've got to have a conversation. I mean, all this is great. We've got to have a conversation about what does this mean for the Tappan Zee Bridge? What does this mean for a school in Yonkers? What does this mean for a bridge? That's what I want to hear. And if we can either have that conversation now and dig down into that now, if we still have the energy to do it, or we can follow up. But we need real specifics. I have a few points here. Number one, on P3 for project specific to the Tappan Zee Bridge, what's the opportunity there? I mean, we've moved forward through the phases on the design build phase. That's part of legislation that had already passed, right? So does that then stop the opportunity for a public-private partnership? Or on the transit-ready component, like we've talked about before, how the George Washington Bridge was transit-ready, that sure as heck didn't happen. For the transit side of this bridge, is there an opportunity to have specific legislation that's project-specific to the Tappan Zee Bridge? I want to know that. I want to get your input on that. Also, as far as on the long-term maintenance contracts, is that something that New York State can take a look at? Is it feasible? As in the same as you suggested with the other, I guess it was Missouri? Okay. Number two, when we're working with the unions, and I know Ross was here, how do you suggest partnering with the unions and bringing them in at a very early level as being a very strong, we want to make sure our union folks are working. Our building trades have, what's that?
Ross is outside there.
Come on, Ross, get back in here. Let's go. It's one of the most powerful men in New York State right there. Our building trades have about 40% unemployment. We want to put those folks to work. And then on the protections for consumers, we've seen public-private P3s in other states where there were protections that were not necessarily put in place, tolls and ratepayers. Tolls went through the roof and ratepayers ended up getting screwed. How do we put those protections in place in New York State to make sure that doesn't happen? And then on the accountability and transparency, as far as prosecutors and prison, my chief of staff wouldn't look good in an orange jumpsuit, so I would like to, either would I, to be quite frank. So what exactly do you mean by that? Let's drill down into that. Okay, did anybody write that down? Cool.
That's a good step in the right direction, because if you notice, as we both suggested, there's design, build, finance, own, operate,
right,
maintain, and DBFOM is what we usually call that. 20% of the way there. You can add finance, operate, maintain without any way, shape, or form doing damage to the design, build statute that's currently in place. When you start, what's it worth to the state? Two factors. Can New York State come up with $99 billion in funding? I don't think you can.
Now, can you just back up that? When you talk specifically about the Tappan Zee Bridge, you have design, build, and then you have finance, operate, maintain.
All right. Under design, build, what happens is the state puts out a request for proposal and says, we want somebody to design and build a replacement for the Tappan Zee Bridge. State's going to pay for it. The question is, can the state pay for it? If you put out a proposal and say, we want to do a design, build, finance, operate, maintain a full public-private partnership, what will happen is private companies will sharpen their pencils, start working on developing proposals, and they'll come back with a fixed number. And what I would suggest in that request for proposal, define, give me two options, with and without a bridge, with and without the train. and you're going to probably find that it does change the price. Actually, I think it's about, if I remember correctly, it's about a little over $1 billion cost more to add the train on there, and it becomes a decision as to which proposal is going to be accepted. Now, one thing, if you do a public sector comparator ahead of time, and we heard some reference to that earlier, where you go through and do what would it cost New York DOT to do this project solely on their own with a design-build component to it? What's the number work out? What's it going to cost them to maintain and operate that bridge for the next 30 years? Work out that number. Then you've got something to compare the private sector offer against. And what General Accountability Office analyses all over the place, we've got them from Canada, from generally a public-private partnership is going to come in anywhere from 7 to 15% less for the whole life cycle cost. Because they're building up, yes, they're going to spend more on the front end, but that's paid off or paid back with the operation and maintenance costs later on being reduced.
Ross, do you want? Would you mind adding a little bit?
The only comments I have, I hear a lot about the Tappan Zee Bridge. I think we've heard plenty of times from the governor's office down and through the authorities that the Tappan Zee will not be a private-public partnership. They just signed an application for loans for $2 billion from the federal government through the TIFIA loan program, not $2 billion entirely from there, but $200 million to generate the $2 billion. And then the Thruway Authority, being a tolling authority, can go out and increase tolls and sell bonds to pay for the remaining cost and pay back the loans as well. But in the long haul, for many other projects, and even for the Tappan Zee Bridge in the future, should it accommodate mass transit, whether it's a bus rapid transit system or mass transit, and at that stage, I would think private-public partnerships would work extremely well, because there we're dealing not only with a bridge, we're dealing with a corridor that's 20 miles long, and stations and new infrastructure that need to be built that are unrelated to the bridge itself, although they will cross the bridge, and the bridge has been designed to accommodate it. So there's a great need here for the injection or the infusion of money for projects, not only for today's projects, but for tomorrow's projects. And while I don't represent labor directly, indirectly, I know they're very excited, too, about this proposal and the idea that there's going to be opportunities in the future that will create jobs, and as the senator said, for a membership that today's experienced somewhere between 25% and 40% unemployment.
Mm. I can't disagree with the word you said.
I was just going to take a moment to respond to your second question, if I may, which was about project-specific legislation. Various states have approached that in different ways. The short answer is yes, that has been done. There have been states that have enacted legislation for just a single project or a defined, specified list of projects. Should I use that one? Connecticut's, well, that's even worse. Connecticut's bill allowed five projects. It didn't specify the projects, but it was only five across sectors. Also, Indiana, although this has changed recently, traditionally, in their legislation that was enacted in 2006, it gave general authorization for PPPs, but the legislature had to approve everything except for a few that were named. Now, what they were able to do with that was to remove that requirement until 2021. I believe that was just last year. So, you know, there are various ways that this has been done to kind of dip a toe in the water, tie it to specific projects. And again, you know, our group generally had the principle that you should separate the debates when possible, but we have seen, you know, about half the states, I would say, that have PPP legislation have either limited to a certain number or list of projects or project-specific legislation.
I mean, from a political perspective, there's, of course, the reason probably in some instances is that specific projects can give impetus to, you know, to pushing back some of those who would, you know, bear a resistance to this legislation, specifically on the Tappan Zee, to what Ross said. I mean, the point is we've already moved forward through certain phases, but I know the governor is setting up a task force specific on the transit side, and I really think it should be our recommendation that a P3 be a large portion of that comprehensive discussion about what to do on the transit side, whether, you know, the number be $5 billion or more in these times, you know, this should, this represents a huge opportunity to fill that gap.
Just one other point, as a trustee on pension funds for the unions on the management side, we are already investing in private-public partnership funds that, unfortunately, don't have any investments in New York State. So it would be nice for the unions across New York State who are investing in these funds to start seeing projects being developed here. And it's another part of the interest that we have.
Let me offer a little piece of history. California's public employee pension fund had the same problem. For 12 years, the state legislature refused to pass legislation in favor of public-private partnerships. When CalPERS decided, oh, we've got to invest in California projects, the state legislature did a 180 within about 48 hours. And when the legislation passed, it shocked all of us. You know, we didn't know where it came. It took us a while to figure out exactly where it came from. But I think the public employee pension funds have got a lot of, should have a lot of skin in the game. These are long-term investments with a reasonable return. This is not wild gyration. This is not Bernie Madoff, et cetera, et cetera. It's a very sensible investment for a pension fund. The Australians have been doing it for how long now? And we're getting into the game now, and it's policemen, firemen, teachers, et cetera, all of them are getting into this thing. But one of the ways that they've been very influential on it is talk with their legislators. The pension fund folks say this is a kind of a logical investment. Instead of us investing it in some other state, let's invest it in Virginia, excuse me, in New York.
What was the shift in California?
Excuse me?
The shift that forced them to invest internally? What was the change?
This audio system sometimes isn't the greatest. But go ahead. Try that again, Senator.
The shift that you talked about in California?
Yeah.
That changed the resistance? What was that?
They passed a statute that allowed for the use of public-private partnerships. They were what New York is now.
Right.
And passed a statute, a very comprehensive one, and specifically for the purpose so that the pension funds could invest in these projects, getting a reasonable return on their investment.
Senator, may I ask a question? I thought it was interesting that the staff circulated the Nossaman model legislation. I'd be really interested to hear the committee comment on this versus looking at Virginia or looking at California, just sort of as a practical matter of advice to the senator's staff of where do you start to draft something that's right for New York?
And in fairness, there are other pieces of legislation out there, too. I'm working with Chuck Michillo, who has absolute awesome guy and a real leader on this front. And from my perspective, I would hope that if we can build a little bit of consensus throughout the state, what you would eventually probably see is something come down from the governor's office. So whether it be, I don't care whose name was on it, we just need to get this done. And we're happy to move the debate forward by crafting the absolute best, most foolproof piece of legislation possible with buy-in from, you know, both the public and the private sector. Great.
If I may respond with awkward audio situations, just briefly to that question, I would say that without commenting specifically on the provisions in the Nossaman model, the idea of a single piece of legislation that would work in every situation doesn't really reflect what's happened in PPP legislation across the states. It helps frame some of the core issues, I think, but the legislation actually looks so different across the states that I think it's important to maybe, I mean, our report, for example, in the back gives a very cursory summary of what each state statute includes and kind of looking at, well, which models match what you're interested in doing. And again, you know, this issue that keeps coming up about tying it to a specific project, in some cases that has really helped, in some cases that was controversial and did not help. So looking at, well, what other states, and I think you mentioned this in your presentation as well, which other states are doing something that's similar to what your goal would be, might be something to think about.
I think, you know, Richard's comment before, once you've seen one PPP, you've seen one PPP.
Yes.
You know, I understand that, but from our standpoint, we need a framework to operate off of. And that, in effect, is the launching pad to do so. Obviously, legislation can be modified and can be duplicated and triplicated, obviously. There's many pieces of legislation that are similar but do different things. But I think what the senator is saying, and for myself, if we have a sense of what the model legislation is that gives us, and I know it shouldn't be one size fits all, but in legislation sometimes it has to be. What's the framework that we can operate off of? You know, if you guys could give us a hand on crafting that, that would be tremendously helpful.
We have in the past. Sorry, but I don't really need that, do I? Okay. Virginia has the longest track record on public-private partnership legislation. It's been almost 20 years since they did the Public-Private Transportation Act, and it's been amended by the state legislature several times. They also have the Virginia Public-Private Education and Infrastructure Act, which is solely for social infrastructure. What Texas did is they took the social infrastructure bill, took it, and they stripped out this, and you know, they adapted it to Texas situations. There were some provisions they said that won't work in Texas. There's some that they'd heard about from another state, and Jamie's absolutely correct. It cherry-picked, you know. We've all got resources, but I strongly recommend it would not be advisable to take any state's legislation or any draft. I don't care if it's Nossaman, I don't care if it's Texas, I don't care if Virginia or California or Connecticut, and then just run it off on a copier, change the name, plug in New York. That's not going to work. It's going to take some. There are some very good models out there, but I have a tendency, maybe it's because I live in Virginia, maybe it's because I've seen them build almost 500 schools and libraries and social infrastructure stuff with the PPEIA. I happen to like that legislation because I think it really captures the strength of the private sector under the control of the public sector and gets a lot of things done.
In the instance with schools, how does it work with the social infrastructure when you're talking about schools as far as the private involvement?
I've seen one public-private partnership. You see, one of the things that the PPEIA allows for is, all right, mentioned this with Yonkers, you know, if a city or a county has a public asset that has potential commercial value to it, allow the private sector to use that for commercial activity for a defined period, and in exchange for that, private sector can build the school. The model came from called the Oyster School in Washington, D.C.
So it's a different facility that it's a trade.
No. What happened is the Oyster School had to be condemned because of lack of funding, but it sat on a 2.5-acre plot. They took the back third of that and put up a 212-unit apartment building, privately owned, privately operated. No, this is not subsidized housing. It's full market value. But what the private sector agreed to is that, okay, in exchange of not paying real estate tax on this for the next 25 years, we'll build you a new school at no cost.
That was part of a TIF district? Is that TIF finance?
It's a variation on a TIF. It's a pilot, payment in lieu of tax.
Have you seen the TIF implementing legislation that we put in the previous budget for New York?
No, I have not.
Okay.
With 50 states and a few other odds and ends we're trying to track, I'd
like your input on that.
Okay. Be glad to.
That wasn't a long time coming.
Yeah, would you just send me the stuff, Jim? We'll take a look at it.
The new TIF legislation is kind of exciting. It's interesting. To tack on to Richard's
especially
comment.
For Yonkers, right? Yeah. Because you have your own income tax, right?
Yeah.
So there's
definitely a possibility there. What Richard describes is great if you're going to build one school. When you're in the position that we're in, we don't have enough other pieces of land. We don't have enough that we can actually, like, give out to other developing. You know, there's a lot of things that go on in New York City, where they'll build a school and there's like a food emporium underneath it, or there's a 20-story luxury, you know, condo. Well, you can't do a whole lot of those in Yonkers.
Right.
Uh, So what you need is a different kind of a plan. And what that comes down to is an availability payment model, which is one of the models that, you know, we don't have a toll. When you do that, and this is in terms of the kind of legislation that you might be thinking about, in addition to general enabling legislation, like, yes, you're allowed to do this, because there isn't an independent source of revenue, there isn't this toll that the private equity can own and regulate the way they want to, what they look for, the nice term that they use, is credit enhancement. In other words, like, well, how do we know? How do we know for sure that we're going to get the payment? Now, one nice thing about being a school system is we're not going anywhere. You know, we're not moving our corporate offices. You know, we're here. But some of the things you may want to think about, for example, the current statutes on intercepts of state aid, it's written in terms of bonds and bondholders. So we can't use that right now if we were talking about a special purpose vehicle in a P3 project. But that's a relatively small tweak. You know, that's a very, very little change which goes toward the credit enhancement possibilities for us that would help a lot. Also in Florida, I believe it was, there was a tunnel project, a P3 tunnel project they did a couple of years ago, where all the state did to provide credit enhancement was to raise the priority of the payment, the availability payment, to the level of municipal debt, as opposed to, because this is a contract, basically. So instead of it being a general contract amount, so they'd stand on line behind more creditors, the state just moved the availability payment, or whatever it was called in Florida. It may not have been called an availability payment.
It's called an availability.
I'm sorry?
You're right. It's
okay,
availability.
It's called availability payment. It just moved it further up the ladder. So that, again, a relatively small tweak to existing laws that, you know, would have to complement a general enabling statute. But you need to keep in mind that those bits and pieces also need to be touched. A general enabling statute may not touch those. The other thing I would just like to briefly reiterate, because other people have said it, what we're getting, the feedback we're getting right now, is that the private equity market is hungry for this. You know, so I don't think you have to worry about, you know, when you're doing the legislation, I don't think you have to do anything to worry about. You don't have to worry about attracting anybody because they're there. I am a, you know, chief administrative officer in a school district, and I'm giving a presentation at a Euromoney seminar next month. Okay, what is it, you know, there's only one reason for that, and that's because these guys want to put their money in a real safe, long-term investment. And, you know, for, you know, to our benefit, a school district, again, we're not going anywhere, we're here, it's a good bet for them.
Thank you. We're going to need your help moving forward.
Got it.
Okay, any other questions?
I think you still have two.
I have a bunch, but I think what we're going to do is we're going to follow up.
Okay.
And unless you want to...
The only thing I was going to say was that you'd asked about protection as far as rates and consumers. I guess I can just say follow up. And, you know, we've looked at, again, with that breakdown, some of how legislation has addressed rate-setting processes and rate-setting caps. So we can certainly help give some examples of that.
Because that's certainly a fear that I'm sure that will be addressed by the public as we go through the through the process. We have a long history with authorities that are not necessarily held accountable in the state of New York. And I wouldn't want to create a new Count Dracula version of our authorities. Mm-hmm. So we would have to put protections in place for the ratepayers.
Yes, and I think all of us, perhaps in one way or another, touch tangentially on this concern about windfall profits.
Right.
And this concern that the public sector is somehow going to outsource this decision to put tolls through the roof to the private sector, that that's the purpose of a PPP, and that's certainly not a public perception that helps.
We want to address that up front. Well, I want to thank each of you for your time. I hope that we can keep in touch, and there's a lot of work that certainly has to be done. And this is an exciting issue. Peter, I saw you nod off once or twice, right?
But it,
It's a tough issue. This doesn't fit itself into a 30-second soundbite, but this is the type of innovation we need to make sure that, that we tap into what will continue to make New York State a great state. And Robert De Niro's on the hook talking about the new New York, so we got to make it happen now. Okay, thanks, everybody. Thanks for your time. Thank you.